You see the region, right? Towards a large dimension, and it goes on to a high value of force. For surface, it is in between, and for line, this is the lowest force and the lowest dimension as well. So, what does it mean? It means some forces are observable for volume elements. Okay. And they act on macro world. Here our dimension is a bit high. Where the forces are mainly a function of volume. For example, you see in the bottom written what are volume forces which are related with the volume. Example is weight, then the inertia force, etc. from mass. Then there is some surface force. What are surface forces? You see there it is written in heat transfer, there is heat transfer coefficient is there, diffusion is another element is there. Biomechanics, there is muscle strength, bone strength, etc. So these sort of forces, they are mostly dependent on the surface area of the object, which it is at. And in nano world, those are basically line forces. You see the corresponding box, there is surface tension, there is surface energy, etc. So these are basically some forces related with length only of the object. So what does it mean? Physical quantities and physical phenomena also, they scale differently with length dimension. So, when we talk about stress and strain, we are in macro mechanics. So, the stress and strain in macro mechanics has an origin in the nano mechanics area also. So, if we go there, the physics in macro mechanics will get modified. There we have altogether a different physics for that dimension. Because the continuum has now broken down. Those laws are not applicable. So now you understand this volume, surface, line, all these lines, they represent some physical laws. So these laws are quite different. If they are represented by these lines, they are different lines, they are different laws. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. So let us go into some depth. And here in this graph, previously it was the dimension scale with force. And in this graph, this is dimension scale with time. So here we have macro time, here we have micro and nano time. Okay. In this lowest range of dimension, lowest range of time, this phenomenon comes under quantum mechanics. Okay. Then comes our nuclear physics, atomic physics, etc. This is our continuum mechanics region. Then comes meso and micro mechanics, etc., etc., sort of thing. So what does it imply? In all these regions, the physical laws are different. We have to use different physics to capture phenomena in these regions. So now let us go into the multiscale modeling in the area of molecular dynamics. Molecular dynamics, now you recall, there was quantum mechanics. Then we came into this molecular dynamics. There is in between an atomic physics was also there, and then all nuclear physics, atomic physics, then there is molecular dynamics. Formation of atom is done, and A molecule is basically combination of several atoms, two or more atoms. So what is mean by molecular dynamics? This also has become quite prevalent nowadays. In mechanical engineering also, there is application of molecular dynamics. There are some molecular dynamics based modeling in mechanical engineering as well. There are some softwares available for that purpose. Now what is this? This is a computer technique or a simulation technique that has to be based on some computational technique, where time evolution of a set of interacting atoms. What does it mean? It is basically the change of state of that molecule or assembly of molecule or something, mixture of atoms and molecules in that domain. What are the physical phenomena happens there? That is what we are going to observe. Like in our macro world, we observe the phenomena, say, through Newtonian mechanics. I am not using energy principle here. There is a similar thing. There also, in molecular dynamics also, one part is your equating forces, other part is conservation of energy. The idea, this idea is universal. Conservation of energy and equilibrium of force, this idea is universal, which is valid through all the scale, because these are general ideas. Like you can see the idea of God, it's a general idea. It is valid. In this universe, this is valid. The only thing is the particular law that describes the phenomenon. Those are different. Okay? So, here, this describing a phenomena means time is a parameter. So, what it does, time evolution of a set of interacting atoms is followed by integrating their equations of motions. Right? This is a particular definition of molecular dynamics. In some way, it is a computer simulation technique. And this is also a statistical mechanics based method, because any atom can be captured only statistically. Its position, its energy, whatever the forces acting, it is not a constant quantity which we can express as we do in our macro. Because I have told this, it is always vibrating.
Yes.
We can measure that vibration, we can measure some energy to that. But every measurement is statistical. This is true in macro world also. But its effect is almost negligible. Like you know our yield stress. Yield stress is basically a statistical quantity, right?
Yes.
We observe many specimens, we develop stress strain diagram, and then we take a particular value as the yield stress of that. But we don't have the idea that this stress value is a statistical, as if this is a constant. We consider it like that. This is not in engineering, undergraduate engineering or anywhere. We do it like that.
It's a constant.
We take it as a constant, but it is not a constant. But this thing, it doesn't make much difference in our normal day application. We can take it as a constant. But that you cannot do. In that level, it has to be a statistical quantity. We must take the statistical parameter there within the physical laws. That is what is meant by this.
So, yeast and hydro will be taking constant in every mile steam. We also constant the yeast and hydro is different types of steam also.
Yeah.
As I said, normal.
Yes. Because you know that there are many parameters on which it acts. It depends actually. Like the diameter of the specimen, the grain structure of the specimen.
Yes, sir.
You know, the ideally, the specimen should go through a particular polishing operation, a particular heat treatment operation. It should maintain a certain dimension. The grit portion is specified. Everything you have to maintain to carry out that tensile test. So it is applicable only for that.
Then every material in the end, we should consider that the material is isotropic and homogeneous.
That is also assumption.
But practically, it is not possible.
It is not possible, but it happens because we are using polycrystalline materials. Whenever we go within the crystal, it is not true, not at all true. But because this is polycrystalline, in every direction you have some crystal, and to sum up in the macro behavior, it is said. And this is quite obvious because, as I have mentioned, the tensile test specimen has to undergo a particular heat processing.
Yes.
So this is producing a particular type of grain structure for a different type of heat processing. It will get a different type of grain structure. Your yield stress value will be different. So it changes. This thing happens. So what are the fundamental thing here? Here also use an energy principle. This is an energy principle. What is here? We see the statistical mechanics method to obtain a set of configuration distributed corresponding to a probability density, okay, in phase space. So what is this phase space? I do not know what they mean, but ordinarily it is meant by a scale of any quantity and its degree. Like your length or displacement and velocity, this is a phase space. Your velocity and acceleration, this is another phase space.
Basically, if we consider the structure of the measure, there are certain difference of range, there are different type of phase.
No, that is different thing. That phase is not what is meant here. At molecular level, you forget about your solid, liquid and gas. We are at the molecular level.
Okay, sir.
So here this phase space is somewhat different. It is not the perlite or whatever. You mean to say those phases of steel. It is not that thing. Okay. So usually phase space means say any scale where some quantity and it derives. Some phenomenon is being observed in that space is a phase space. The probability density of this total quantity, and here you see this gamma represent the set of position. That means it is a description of the atomic positions, this gamma. And what is H here, this H is known as Hamiltonian. We will see afterwards what is Hamiltonian. It's an operator operating on gamma. So this Hamiltonian operating on this gamma, it also gives rise an energy thing. And this E is total energy. Sometimes it is in total, usually they are taken as specific, that means sparing. And this total always consist of two parts. One is kinetic, other one is potential. You see that? Then there is delta, this is a Dirac function. You know Dirac function which makes it 0 or 1 sometimes, so use it. In some integration, something if I into fj, if I equal to j is 1, if I not equal to j is 0. This Dirac function. So it is that Dirac function. There is the Dirac function. So what it is taking? So in this quantity, only those states whose total energy is E, that would be taken into consideration. So that means this is conserved. Something is conserved by using this particular principle. But it is fundamentally that conservation law of energy, the conservation. Right. So then this total energy is k plus v, k is kinetic energy, v is potential energy, we know that. But they come not from our usual state energy, work function, etc. Their origin is somewhat different. If we go into it, you see, this k, it comes from the vibration of those atoms, etc. It is vibrating, so there is a kinetic energy, you increase temperature, that vibration will increase, it will go on increasing temperature, solid will become liquid like that. So fundamentally this kinetic energy comes from the vibration of the atom. So this is the equation of kinetic energy. This has to be mass of the molecule or atom. If there are n number of atoms, I runs from 1 to 8. And here this V, it is a potential. So potential is always something like our strain energy. Something is stored somewhere. Some energy is stored somewhere. Where from in atomic level this stored energy will come? It's basically interaction between two atoms.
Yes.
Whenever two atoms are in equilibrium, there is some energy locked.
Yes.
You impart more energy, it will break, or some other phenomena will happen. Okay. So this potential is coming from the position of the atoms. Yes. So that is what was there in this relation. This V. Corresponding in phase space, something is written there. K is instantaneous kinetic energy and V is the potential function corresponding to the position of the atoms. To obtain a set of configuration, this is the term. This set of configuration is defined by the position of the atoms. So if that is known, this V can be computed. It is interaction of n number of atoms. But again,
V is the potential function depending on the position of the atom.
That is written here.
As a single parameter.
Okay, this is written here. And then you see again, this is basically summation of the potential between two atoms. This is the usual. Like here, the individual atom has kinetic energy and they are summed up. Here also we will see the ultimate potential comes up from the potential of a pair. Pair means interaction between two atoms. Okay. So that way if there are n number of atoms, how many interactions will be there? N minus 1 into n minus 2 into n minus 3 like that. It will not be repeated. Right.
So, if we have to do the number of interactions, we can see.
No. You see, a particular atom cannot interact with itself.
Oh, yes.
Right?
Yes, yes.
You can say it is n minus 1 on C2, something like that.
Yes,
sir. Okay. Okay, whatever. And this kinetic energy is obtained from another way also. Okay. actually it is obtained from a temperature.
Yes.
This K yields temperature and V yields force. So if we can compute K from there, there is another expression of average kinetic energy. It is written here. Below this, it is written here. This K, suffix V is Boltzmann's constant. So, for each degree of freedom, it is half KB into T. And 3 degree of freedom system in general is 3 into V. So, if that is known from the atomic level, this KB can be computed for a given T. Okay. Temperature T, because here all these equations are valid for a given temperature T. Okay. This phenomenon is happening for a particular temperature T. That is given. If T changes, the whole phenomenon will change.
So in the expression of KB, there are two terms of KB. These two KB can be as KB equal to E to the power minus H.
Yeah. That is there.
These two KB is Boltzmann constant. Now there are two kinds.
No, they are the Boltzmann constant. You can say this is a complicated expression, but still it is solvable.
Yes.
It is solvable. Actually, what I feel it is like that. I am no expert in that area. I have to explore or you do one thing. You have this slide. You find out what is Boltzmann's constant and check what is the expression of Boltzmann constant, how it is.
Boltzmann constant into universal gas constant divided by atomic mass of the matter.
That's okay. Whatever you do it, and let me know. I am not very sure. So, you check whether this expression is correct or not, otherwise I should make it correct. Confirm me. Okay. What is written below that? An estimate of temperature is therefore directly obtained. Proof. It is written here. Problem.
Sir.
What I should do?
What is the last option that you can have?
This one. Cool skin, okay. By the way, have the slides. You explore it. And then let me know how we can get rid of that. It is still there. An estimate of temperature is there for whatever is there, there is something in reading. Okay.
I think.
You don't know this part. Good. Okay, now, this part was fine. This kinetic energy part, we will see later that there is a function of temperature. Temperature changes, this thing will change. Let us go into this potential. So, this potential, as I have mentioned, it is basically interaction of a single pair. So we have to find out how many pairs is possible, and then we will make it a summation like this to get this total potential energy. Now what is that potential? And why we are so interested with that potential? If that potential is known, then we always know that force is derivative of the potential. This is also the same concept. Concept is there. So this potential is the result. Force is the cause. You have to have a potential to get a force. Unless you have potential, you cannot generate a force. This is true. This is what we also use in our common parlance. That person has potential. That means that person has something within him to produce something. So it is like that. It is something universal law. There has to be a potential, the derivative of which is force. Okay. Now, how to find out this potential? This is what I have mentioned. For each pair, we have to determine the potential. This is the thing. The summation of what it indicates, you will understand this thing. It's a pair-wise information. So, the description of this potential, it is not unique. The most common pair-wise potential description is known as Lennard-Jones potential. Now, if you study a book on molecular dynamics, molecular modeling, you will find there are at least 10-12 potentials. Nowadays, it is in developmental stage also in that level. So, new potentials are coming up. It is not always pair-wise. They are trying to develop some potential which can take number of atoms in a single go like that. So, whatever, let us take, initially it was predicted by David Jones. It is also known as 12-6 potential because of this 12 and 6 power, these powers. These two quantities again has some significance. Okay. So this is the expression of that potential. Potential, this phi means some energy. Okay. So that is this energy. Or we can say it is phi. It is the same thing. Now there are, how many quantities are there? There is an epsilon, there is sigma, there is alpha. And then there are powers. What does it mean? Say this r or small r is the distance between two intermediate particles. Epsilon is the depth of the potential. What does it mean if we make a plot of this potential with r? It's pumping at a curve, whatever. We can generate a curve. For each value of R, we can generate it. And the minimum value. This minimum value is this epsilon. So it is also known as depth of the potential wave. Referred as dispersion energy, whatever. These are not very well known to us. And what is sigma? It is distance, that means it is a particular value of R. At the value of R, where the potential value is 0, that is sigma. Is the distance at which the particle-particle potential energy is 0. Clear? This is often referred to as the size of the particle. And it has a minimum value there, whatever is measured. For example, something. Let us make a plot of this thing and see how it looks. Well, this is the thing. So what is epsilon value? This particular value, this is epsilon value. Here it is written as E0. Sometimes epsilon is also denoted by E0. This is the depth of the potential well. Understand? Here we have two components, to the power 12 and to the power 6. Okay?
Yes.
So these two are represented by that blue colored lines. Okay? You see, one part produces repulsion, other one produces
attraction.
Exactly. And what is the significance of that particular point where derivative of the energy is 0. You observe this figure.
Yes.
This is the net energy curve. So, at that point, if we take a derivative, its derivative is 0. So, this happens at this particular distance.
Okay. So, if the derivative is 0,
force is zero.
That means the attractive force and repulsive force will be.
This is net energy.
Yes.
Nothing is there. Well,
yes.
So it's a stable position.
Yes.
But what is that sigma value? Sigma value is this particular value. Where the value of energy is zero, this particular distance is sigma. But this is the equilibrium force. Because that equilibrium force will balance. And for energy, it is conservation. Understood? So this is the graphical plot of Leonard-Jones potential. Something is written here. This potential has an attraction tail. So in general, follow the red curve towards large value of R. Okay. The nature is attraction. So at two atoms which are at large distance, there is an attraction.
Yes.
But when we carry out molecular dynamics modeling, cannot go into it. So those are special tricks there. How much you are taking into consideration, up to which distance. Beyond which you have to force it, zero. Those are particular detailing of molecular dynamics modeling. Okay, it is at large value of R, it is attraction. And what happens at small values? Very simple, sir.
Yes, sir. The same molecular atom will be, if the shorter is distance, they are always repulsive.
They will try to repulsive force.
Yes, sir.
So that is there in the graph itself, it is quite clear. So it reaches a minimum around 1.122 sigma. Right? That means this is sigma. And this is about 1.122 sigma.
Okay, sir.
It is not universally true, but in general it is like that.
Okay, sir.
And it is also written here, you see, equilibrium separation, that means say this distance is R0. At this point, if this is R0. R value is R0 here. E value is E0 here.
Yeah.
So that's why this 0.3 nanometer is an approximate point.
Approximate.
Repulsive shorter distance passing through zero. This is what we have described. Eh? So this is a plot of that potential. Now you get force. Derivative of this curve will give us force. So this is again Leonard-Jones potential. That plot sigma is shown here. Sigma epsilon is shown here. So what is changed in other potentials is shown earlier. Here, you see, in different, I have talked about other type of potentials, right? Not only LJ potential, there are other type of potentials. What is changed is this 12/6. Okay. Sometimes 7/9 they are used instead of this 12/6. And then there are some values A and B. From here, we can express it like this. So in this expression, sometimes A and B are changed. This A and M values, they are known as N and M. It is a general form in which it is N and M. For Leonard-Jones, they are 12/6. Otherwise, there are a family of potentials. Okay, and then when we go into the derivative of this curve, we get force. Then, in case of force, that means when we are in force domain, there is an attractive force that is also known as van der Waals attractive force. Right? Well, then sigma that we have discussed. Sigma gives a measurement of how close to non-bounding can get the radius. Something more is there. Let us come here. So it is shown here. This is the plot of LJ potential. Its derivative is shown. At this point, force is zero. This is what we have already mentioned. Shown here. And now you see, if this energy is known, we can get the force. If this force diagram is known, we can also get that data. This one here. The energy will come from this diagram. It's an integration over the force. And this force is basically derivative of this energy. But it is convenient to work with energy than forces. This is discussed in much detail in the very development of the mechanics. In our historical development, I have emphasized on energy formulation to a large extent. I have talked about limitations of Newtonian mechanics. So it is always more useful or more easy to work with energy expressions. One of the reasons is energy expressions are scalar, whereas force, they are vector. So these things we will see afterwards also when we will discuss these energy principles in detail. But that is true in every area of physics. That is a standard thing. These laws are the laws of nature, fundamental laws of nature. Everything is laws of nature, whatever we discuss in physics. Physics is the subject where laws of the nature is described. But these two, equilibrium of force and conservation of energy, these are the two ultimate equations of the physics. The physics. Right. So from this, what we get elemental bonding. Right. And if we see this elemental bonding, that means from energy curve we get force curve, from this force curve we get energy bonding, net force has to be zero for equilibrium. Find that, we do it. Further detailing we will get here. Some link is given here. You go there, you see some more things are there. It is the same thing for actual LJ potential, it is common. Not elaborating on it, we have discussed. And then here you see there are two parts, right? One is repulsive part in this region, and then there is an attractive part towards the bottom, there is an attractive part. Right? So this repulsive part and attractive part, there are some type of bonding which happens. Now this secondary bonding is van der Waals bonding, which means this is basically that van der Waals force, if two atoms are at large distance, there is an attraction, they will come towards each other. But then there has to be a primary bonding. And the most powerful bonding is ionic. Then there is covalent bonding. I think you have gone through this type of bonding in your higher secondary course. Right?
Covalent bonding is the powerful set.
Oh, covalent bonding is more powerful.
Okay.
So it requires more charge to separate the covalent bond.
Yes.
Okay. Possible. Okay, then there is metallic bond also.
The secondary
one
is very weak
one,
hydrogen
one. Right. Like that. Exactly. So these are type of bonding. You did it in your higher secondary course.
Yes, sir.
Some structure of atoms and those things. Bohr's model, etc.
Yes, sir. Chemistry.
Achha. Yes. Physical chemistry.
Yes.
No,
our chemistry is a covalent bond.
Good. Very good. So what is there? And then there is a plot of that thing only. Van der Waals bonding. For hydrogen atom, this is the plot. They are known as Van der Waals bonding for hydrogen atom. Now this particular this type of diagram, from this diagram, what we This gives rise to many phenomena which we observe in macro. That means in continuum mechanics, we use Hooke's law, we use anisotropic material property, then we use this coefficient of thermal expansion, etc. All these things, they are fundamentally derived from this type of interaction terms, energy and force, this type of interaction terms, lot of energies and this force. How? This is quite easy, we will see it. This is the formation of hydrogen atom, hydrogen molecule H2 from two different hydrogen atoms. How this is formed? It is shown here. The particular value is also shown. This is that epsilon value and something, some R0 value is also there. So different material, this is also specified here. So you understand what is sigma, what is this epsilon, and this is epsilon per kb. What is there?
This is our Boltzmann constant value is 1.38 into 21 is 24. 1.38 into 21 is 24.
Achha. For?
Sir, the Boltzmann constant value.
It is a universal constant value.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Achha. So, when?
No, sir, it is not a universal. It is a. Depend on the atomic weight of the.
Achha, atomic weight.
Yes, sir.
So, whatever for Van der Waals bonding of different materials, the values are specified. Right?
Okay, sir.
Now, again, these curves, they are a function of temperature. So, these things are at some specified temperature which is not there, but it has to be like that. For different temperature, it will change. And it is quite clear, you see. If temperature changes, this particular distance, it will change.
Yes, sir.
So that means it is giving rise to that coefficient of thermal expansion.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So this is the thing we are crystal binding, we are not going into. Things, other things are there. So let us come to this thing where you see in totality our energy was coming from kinetic energy and a potential energy. So here potential energy is represented by this W. So its change is shown here. Now it is not for an atom as such. Say we have a crystal solid. Something is there, not two atoms, but say something, a body is there, where we can use the concept of stress and strain. Okay, at that level, if we use it, this is the expression of our potential energy, stress into strain. Why it is like that?
Stress into area, force.
And this is in totality, volume element is 1, 2, 3, right? 1, 2, 3 is this volume. This epsilon and sigma, that is the energy.
Yes, sir. Sigma 1, 1 into dx2 into dx3. This is the force. And d epsilon.
This is the displacement.
This is the displacement.
But you can look at it in this way also. This sigma into epsilon, which is your energy.
Yes.
And that is energy per unit volume.
Yes.
So you multiply with dx1, dx2, dx3.
Yes.
Same
thing. Same thing.
Okay. Fine. So this is how we calculate it. And actually we calculate it like this.
Yes.
Not by using the concept of force and displacement, by using the concept of stress and strain with the volume. Okay. And what is this Q? This is that kinetic energy, and here kinetic energy is calculated from here.
From temperature,
and this S is something entropy, the change in entropy. Something is there, I am not aware of this thing, and then equating all these, some relation between the stress, strain, and temperature.
Yes.
It will come, temperature is there in kinetic energy, T is there.
Yes.
And then in potential energy, stress and strain is there. If this is total energy and it is conserved, then there has to be a conservation which is in coming from interaction of stress, strain, temperature.
Yes.
So this is the picture at atomic level. Some assumption is there, reversal of this thing, that thing.
Yes, other if it is not reversal, this equation is not valid by taking the
that
is
another term, and
is
generally
present.
The
dissipation
part, right? Yes, sir. Okay, so that is the basic genesis. Whatever is there, I am not going in. It is the same description, basically. And this is how the coefficient of thermal expansion is computed with temperature, the spacing changes. It is the same potential. So, okay, this is somewhat, this is not molecular dynamics analysis. This is some idea about that. Now, you won't get anything about molecular dynamics from this. You have to study. But this might help you in your study. Some idea is there. Yeah, how stress and strain are generated. So, what is the outcome of this observation? The outcome is that the stress and strain, they are comes fundamentally with temperature. Everything is in a single equation. So, there are interaction between stress, strain, and temperature.